Good afternoon and warm welcome to all. We are here today to discuss on how to tantalize a palate. Tantalizing a palate pertains to food. Food pertains to what we eat every day. I am here with Chef Pankaj Bhaduria, whom you have heard all about, the first MasterChef winner from India, and the same MasterChef finalist, Chef Kanda Nijhawan, is with us here to discuss and talk about how one can tantalize a palate with the ingredients available in our own kitchen. I would want Chef Bhaduria to put some light on this and share her views how one can tantalize the palate.
Okay. Hello, everybody. Thank you for inviting me to Chandigarh, first of all. It's a pleasure to be here. And Rajan, food is a very sensory experience, right? So I believe the only way to tantalize your palate is, of course, you need to tantalize your senses, right? And that is why I guess so much emphasis is paid on how beautiful a food, you know, a particular dish looks on a plate, on your table. But I think even before that, what hits you is the beautiful...
The ENT.
The ENT, yes. Everything needs to be working in perfect
harmony. Here, ENT, as we speak of ENT, we are talking about your eyes, because the first contact you have with a dish or food is with your eyes. So once it appeals to your eyes, you tend to
look toward it and say, yeah, this is nice, I'd like to pick this up. Imagine a child in a candy store, or imagine a child in a bakery shop, and how does a child choose what to pick up? This looks pretty, this looks nice, this is colorful, I want this, I want this, I want this. So the first thing that attracts you, of course, is the appearance, and then of course you take in the aroma. But as I like to say, all five senses included, you see, you smell, but you touch and feel your food, and then it comes on your palate. But what about your ears? Right? Are they also involved? Of course. Imagine you're sitting in a restaurant and suddenly somebody orders a sizzler, and that sizzler plate passes by you, everybody immediately turns.
Yeah.
Right? So you love that sizzling sound.
Correct.
Right? So food is a very, very sensory experience, and if you can get that combination right to attract all your senses together, you've managed to tantalize the palate.
Oh, wonderful. How would you be more creative? How would you suggest one can be creative in tantalizing one's palate in generally when you're cooking at home?
So you see, what happens is, we are very lucky in India. We've got such fantastic food, and we have such beautiful spices to play around with. But the one big mistake we make is the way we cook our food. You know, we end up killing everything. So, for example, if I'm doing aloo gobi, a very simple thing at home, in the end, aloo gobi, gajar matar, everything is going to look like that yellow and brown mash of things. Right? If we can avoid that, if we can let food retain its color, right? If we can, very simple changes that you need to make in how you cook. Why is restaurant food so appealing? I'll tell you one simple example. They will do a mixed veg, you do a mixed veg, they would both look different. Why is that so? So what they would do is they'll blanch their vegetables first and then, you know, cool them down in ice cold water. That will help retain the color, right? It's partially cooked, so they didn't have to really mash it up while they're cooking. So the actual cooking process takes lesser time in the pan. That helps to retain the color. It looks beautiful and you say, wow, right? So a few changes if we could bring about in our cooking styles, I think that would make all the difference.
When you say a few changes, could you be more explicit on that?
So I think bringing about a few changes in the cooking methods, if you could use more of roasting. Why does tandoori chicken look so appealing? Because it has managed to retain the color that it was intended to be. right? Even if you're not adding artificial food colors, what we do is we will mix Kashmiri lal mirch with a little mustard oil, you know, and that gives it a beautiful color, that gives it a beautiful aroma as well once it goes into the pan. But if we can, you know, change a few cooking methods, include more of blanching, include more of maybe grilling, even if it is pan grilling, you need not have a, you know, grill at home, even if it is pan grilled food, I think it will look more pretty, it will retain the nutrient values of food, even flash frying for that matter, you know, all these little changes will help to retain the nutrient value as well, because you're not overcooking it, you're not killing it, and it will help you to allow food look pretty as it is supposed to be.
Okay, could you could throw some light on how we can, as general people at home, when you're cooking in the our kitchens, how can we play around with spices to enhance the palate, to tantalize the palate?
I think what we do is we have something called garam masala in our kitchen, right? So everything ends up tasting the same, right? If we could learn how to individualize spices and then play with that flavor, for example, if I'm traveling Europe and I go to a restaurant and I order, so this is thyme flavored or this is rosemary flavored, did you ever try to, you know, keep things or keep our spices apart? If I'm doing a firmi, if I do a sofia firmi, that one flavor will stand out. Right.
Correct.
Similarly, if I'm doing, say, an ajwaini murgh tikka, I would allow the ajwain to stand out. Let me not any garam masala to mess it up again. Right. So, if we could learn how to individualize our spices, you know, understand how beautiful each one of them can be. One of my, or I would say my signature dish is a cinnamon and caramel firmi. So, the cinnamon flavor in firmi, you top with the caramel sauce, two beautiful flavors that complement each other so beautifully, yet stand out. I guess that's what needs to be done. Every woman has all these spices in her kitchen. Every woman has beautiful colors in the form of turmeric or in the form of Kashmiri lal mirch or in the form of, you know, just adding a little lemon juice to turmeric changes the color absolutely. Right. So if you could learn how these things could work, I think that will make your food as good as restaurant food, or I would say even better, because it would be it would be cooked with love, it would be cooked with a lot of attention, and I think that makes all the difference.
That absolutely, that's my belief also. Anything could cook with passion, with from your heart, like Ghera Saab said earlier, you don't have to go to universities to learn. You can be a chef, you can be a home chef, you can be a chef if you have the passion to do it.
Absolutely.
You have to have the grit and passion to learn. To cook anything that's cooked with passion today, I think comes out, the dish that comes out is unbeatable.
Absolutely.
In flavors, in presentation,
everything.
What do you think about presentation?
I think that's a very, very vital part of food preparation. Whenever I start, I always have the end product in mind. So I first imagine how things are going to look on my plate.
But what about if we are talking generally in the kitchens, if the ladies in the kitchens are doing it, how much innovative can they be in plating?
Why do we add coriander in the end? It's not just for the fragrance, because we know that break of green is going to look so beautiful on a dish, right? Sometimes we'll fry a red chili and then add it on the top, because we know that break of color is going to add an eye appeal. So we've already been doing that, maybe subconsciously, but if we could, you know, just pay a little more attention, ki isko aisa karne se, yes, this might, you know, change the entire appearance of things. So if I'm doing anything at home, say I'm doing a dal tadka. So I finish my dal, I complete the tadka and I mix it with the dal and I cook it a little while for the flavors to be absorbed and then I put it on my bowl. But in the end, if I can just take a little desi ghee and add a little red chili and then pour it on the top, it adds a beautiful eye appeal. That's all that needs to be done. You know, you can make your ghar ka khana also look very beautiful and very eye appealing.
True. Thank you so much. I come to Chef Kandla. Welcome, Chef Kandla.
Thank you. Thank you, Rajan.
What is your take on tantalizing the palate, Chef?
I think food is really the mainstay of our very existence. I mean, when they say love and fresh air, I think it's complete bunkum. I think food is absolutely important. Ek nakam shayar ne bola hai na, ishq mein kuch bhi nahi rakha hai, jo bhi rakha hai, fridge mein rakha hai. Food's all important. It is the way we eat it. There was a time maybe 60 years ago when the tired farmer just came home and ate a boiled rice and a dal cooked by his wife. And that was it, you know. But right now we need to have the food, the flavors of various levels and dimensions of it coming forth. And actually, it becomes like an experience. And in fact, today I find that food has become more like a suspense thriller. It's quite like Narcos. Isko khayenge to kya niklega? If we bite into this, what's the next flavor which will hit the palate? Because it has to have that element of surprise. It has to have that entire experience, as Rajan said beautifully. It is a case of the eyes and then the nose and then the tongue. Except the last time Rajan and I talked, I was totally flummoxed. I said, why are you talking ear, nose, throat, doctors, for God's sake, you know? What is ENT, you know? So I said, hey, come on, this is the culinary technology of ENT. So you really do begin to look at it with your eyes. And of course, now you find that the plating is phenomenal. You'll find that the food is not lying like a piece of fish here and a pile of rice somewhere else and some potatoes hovering in the background. It is going to be a case of a pylon of food. It is stacked together to give you eye appeal. It's got a height, which is practically like the food is just beckoning to be picked up and eaten. Of course, sometimes you do have a plating where you have something which is very questionable in origin. And it's probably very insubstantial in quantity. Rajan, I'm complaining about restaurant food. And at the end of it all, it may be just mediocre at the most when you eat it as well. And of course, plating also requires that you may have 3 drops of mayonnaise, and you may have 1 streak of a Thousand Island dressing, and you may have 1 piece of Norwegian salmon that's in pan seared with a little bit of arboreal rice under it and a bit of maybe bell peppers or something added to it. Sometimes you find that the food may look dry to you because the sauces element is so little. If you put in more sauces, it's going to become like a flood. And then if it's got a mess in a bowl, it looks like something the cat dragged in. So that's no good to you. It has to be every element showing up separately. And you say, okay, this is the chicken and this is the this and this is the that. So put together, it must have a concord. It should not be a discord. You can't just go into, say, fusion cooking. Like, ab adrak wali chai hai. Would you seriously want to make a lasan wali chai? Obviously not. So you have to have the actual components blending together and making good music. That's all important. The mistake I find that we make in our Indian kitchens, and I mean the common housewife here, Chef Rajan, is that we don't believe in less is more. I mean, I know people who, I've gone for a judgment and someone's tossed up a wonderful looking salad. And they said, why haven't I won this? Maine isme spinach bhi dala, maine isme capsicum bhi dala, maine salad leaf bhi dala, maine gajar bhi dali, maine chana bhi dala, maine dhania bhi dala, maine corn bhi dala. So many components put into a place. You don't know what you're eating at the end of it all. And then they say they also put in mayonnaise and put in vinegar and put in lemon juice. So you find that they're putting in too many similar ingredients from the same family and hoping that a lot of things may achha hi banega. That doesn't work like that at all. It has to be a few components. And I also firmly believe that when you're making a dish, please, I think we need to think about which is the heroine of the food. Which exact element, like as Chef Pankaj said, if you're making a ajwaini machhi, then ajwain it is. For God's sake, don't load in an overdose full of cinnamon and garam masala into it, because you don't know what you're eating. So if you have a component which is a heroine, let the heroine sing, for God's sake. Let the other sidekicks just be a gentle chorus. It shouldn't hit you like a bullet between your two eyes, like my bindi here. It should be gentle, shimmering waves of flavor coming forth to you, like the wave that Sukhna Lake right here, maybe, you know. So, Rajan, my take on food, as I said, I think it was very varied. I've given you my general idea about this. I also, yes, feel that in India, I honestly believe that in England and America and in the Western world, if they have one cupboard full of herbs and oils and the mayonnaise and the Dijon mustard, trust me, I think, have a warehouse. It is a godam. There are so many. My dear husband says, why do you have so many jars and components and ingredients? Kitni bottle rakhti hai, phekti kyun nahi hai? We actually do have so many of them. And we do use them to an advantage when we team them together so that they make a good marriage of one or the other. Here again, the common housewife may say, put in the kali sarso, put in the jeera, put in the rai. There's a mistake. you don't know what you're eating at the end of it all. So tantalizing the palate on a home level, I would say, is yes, certainly that it must have character. It must be distinct in what you are trying to project and not have everything or too much of anything. I also find people say, we put in vinegar and put in lemon juice. Now, why would you do that? They're both acid components. One should be more than enough. You don't need to do that. Secondly, I find that when the restaurant food comes to you, it is a sight to behold. It's an individual portion. And you're going to look at a piece of chicken and maybe a little mound of rice on the side and maybe a baked potato. At home, in India, khana phir bhi dongon mein banke aapke saamne hi aata hai. What can we do to improve it? I would say simply is A, don't please cook mushrooms and cook chana and cook aloo on the same day. They all look the same. They have no color, they have no texture. Secondly, I would say what I strongly believe is that we tend to cook our food to death, as Chef Pankaj said as well. We do cook it to death.
I totally believe that.
No character left in it anymore. We need to learn about the undercooking. And I know blanching is okay, but we must learn the technique that you don't just blanch a cup full of mutter and 3 cups of water and throw the water away. But then you're losing on the nourishment that is already going away. I, for one, would, you know, boil my carrots and peas and maybe cauliflower separately, bit by bit, and save up the stock and make a soup out of it. If the housewife doesn't know that, she throw it away, you're going to lose a lot of nutrients and trace elements which are essential for our very existence, literally.
Like rightfully said by Chef Kandla, we have a very rich heritage of food in India. Every 100 kilometers, the food changes, the cuisine changes, the taste changes, the flavors change. We actually have to learn, and need of the hour to learn is how to be specific with spices. What spice to use, how much to use in quantum. Quantum is very important in cooking. You put a bit more and you kill the dish. To get the best out, you have to have a very balanced and a very accurate, I would say, input of spices in there. What's your take on spices here?
Absolutely. As I said, spices are... they can never be the hero of the food. They are, I would say, they are the catalyst. Absolutely catalysts which will bring out what food is all about. You know, they are the ones, they are the flavor enhancers, they are the perfect notes to the harmony, right? Without which it may seem a little incomplete. But again, how much of it is important? A little more will kill what you're trying to create, a little less will show it is not even there. They won't even have their presence marked that way, right? And again, we need to remember all these herbs and spices have concentrated flavors, so to speak. So if I'm using, say, fresh parsley, I might be adding a lot of it. But if I'm using dried parsley, I'll have to cut down to the, you know, just about a third of it to be able to get that flavor, because it's already been brought down to a very compact size, concentrated level. So, kasuri methi, if I'm cooking, say, a bunch full of kasuri methi, which is fresh, beautiful. But with the same amount of potatoes, if I was to add the same amount of kasuri methi that I would be using fresh, my God, I'm killing everything there. It'll turn so bitter, right? And so, spices would work beautifully in bringing out what I'm trying to create, but they can never be the ruler, so to speak.
Absolutely,
of.
Absolutely. Truly
I love
that.
What she said, the heroine. Everybody says the hero dish, the hero of the dish. I love what she said, the heroine of the dish. Thank you, Kandla.
Because you see, a lot of foods can be so devoid of flavor on their own.
Absolutely.
Chef Rajan, you tell me, how good is a piece of boiled chicken, or how good is a piece of just straightforward broccoli? You don't want to, you want to run away in the opposite direction if it's not got the correct flavoring and it's got some enhancers to add on to it. The zing really comes from our spices. Of course, the Western world adds in their own jalapenos and they may add in their pickles into it, and of course they've got their own sauces. But what we have here, I think we're sitting on a gold mine.
Absolutely, totally believe that.
And I think it was the East India Company discovered it long, long ago, didn't they, when they wanted our cloves and peppercorn.
Absolutely, very rightly said, Chef Kandla. I travel a lot for my food sojourns. I travel to different states in India just to learn about their eating habits and how they cook. And lastly, I was in Assam for 5 days. And I learned from there, they cook their meals in basic three ingredients. Turmeric,
chili,
and salt. And a bit of zeera, which certain dishes have, certain don't. These are three main ingredients they use and create some amazing dishes in their cuisine. I wish we could learn from them, you know, how to create. See, like Chef Bhaduria just rightfully said, the enhancers have to be very well balanced. You don't need to be like we have butter chicken. It's all about butter chicken. What do you taste there? It's about tomatoes and cream. You don't even taste the chicken there. Why don't you you don't get a taste of chicken? Because it's overpowering. And when it's overpowering, you kill the dish. You call it butter chicken, yes, we love our butter chicken. I mean, anywhere we go, we love our butter chicken. But if I compare it with what I learned in Assam, they make a chicken called chicken mandhaniya, which is just got these three ingredients, turmeric, salt, and zeera. And they add little bit of dhania in the end, which is called mandhaniya, which is very similar to our dhania, which we use at home in Punjab or in anywhere in Haryana. But it actually brings out the dish, the chicken, the flavors of chicken in it. With of course, the spices are marriage to that dish. So I would suggest, let's try, start cooking at home in our kitchens, dishes which we don't need to overpower with spices. What do you say?
Yeah, absolutely. An example, yesterday I was here, last night I was there in Sector 8 market, and I enjoyed some of that grilled chicken that a gentleman was selling. Had no flavors except for a brushing of oil, salt and pepper. And my God, it tasted so good. Simply the way it had been.
You're just underplaying everything else. Like if you,
yes,
even if you
less
take just
more.
A fish which has just got some lemon juice and some parsley butter, it's lovely. You don't
absolutely
need to go with
absolutely
it.
You don't need to have spices or, you know, overpowering
it. It just makes the fish sing. It's got its flavors right, and you're not overpowering it. And of course, it has to be undercooked. There's one more thing again, the undercooking comes in. You know, we tend to just, we will make a fish curry and then cover it up and have a huge amount of coconut milk, and everything is merrily simmering away for hours. And by the end of it, you find the coconut milk may have split. The fish is hardened because it's been overcooked. This cooking technique, I find, is what's slightly missing in most households still in India.
Yeah,
I don't know where
I totally agree with
you.
We
don't know where to add something as well.
We do tend to, in our kitchens, when we cook, we do tend to overcook our food. We're killing the nutrients first, we're killing the flavors. All that is left is spices there. I mean, what you're having at home or what you're eating is just spices, nothing beyond spices.
Absolutely, I agree. And so, we also need to, learn how to play around with spices. The same spices in a different combination can create wonders. For example, if you take up the Bengali panchfuran, that's such a beautiful combination of sweet flavors. You have the sauf and the mangal, and in the right quantity, they will give you such a sweet flavor to the entire dish. On the other hand, if I pick up a Punjabi garam masala, which is lal mirch and gol mirch and kasuri methi and dhania and zeera, again tossed, and bursting with flavor, that's such a beautiful combination. Right.
Every state has them.
In fact, one of the books that I have done, it's called The Secret and the Spice Mix, and it is all about the different spice mixes in the entire country. 50 spice mixes we put in that.
Look at how the Mumbaikars love singing, yelling about the Gora Masala.
Not just the Gora Masala, if you
likewise, it's Kolhapur also. If
yes,
look
the,
at Kolhapur.
The Kala Masala or the Bottle Masala of the East Indian community, which is so very different and so very special.
I think in India we find that when you go down the supermarket aisle, Pankaj, I find that they'll always only pick up, acha ye chalo pav bhaji masala le lete hain, ye biryani masala le lete hain, Kashmiri masala le lete hain. You know, there are Shahi paneer masala, there's a mutton masala.
I understand the Kashmiri masala because that's a tikki masala.
So that's one more grouse I have. I know Vivek's mother used to grind her own masalas. Mm-hmm. They were carefully measured, they were sunned, they were cleaned and picked properly, and then they were ground freshly. And the aroma, I mean, you could you could know, but you know, maybe five houses away as to what my mother-in-law was cooking because you could smell the food. Now, unfortunately, I have one more grouse about commercial cooking. Of course, we're not talking about commercial cooking. There's so much of synthetic flavors in the market right now that you can pick up just a few drops of biryani essence and put it into your biryani, or you can cook. You can pick up a pani puri masala, you can pick up a biryani masala, you can pick up a rogan josh masala. And it's not a masala, mind you. It's a flavor of the masala which will come forth. Actually, just a bottle with some liquid in it. You just have to put a few drops of that. So in our own homes, of course, we avoid doing that, and we have the actual thing. So we work on it. But fast food has taken over. Women are working, and because both the husband and wife are, you know, away at jobs, it becomes more difficult for a lady to say, ki main haath se chutney bana rahi hun, ya main apna palak ko kaat ke lunch kar rahi hun. People are picking up tin foods, they're picking up sauces and condiments, they're picking up ready foods, they're picking up the TV dinners as abroad, which are so popular. It's all happening here as well, unfortunately, you know, because you go to the freezer area, you can pick up aloo parathas which are lying there and you can stick them in the freezer for 6 months and keep eating them afterwards. So real food and real cooking, they have taken a bit of a setback because the women are working, and so you consequently and subsequently find that there's less of good cooking happening. But I think when the lady dons the apron on Saturday, she can still create magic and tantalize the palate, so to speak, with a lot of good foods. And we have our summer vegetables and our winter vegetables and the variations that come along with it, because in our climate here, it can be acutely hot, it can be freezing cold as well, and it can be moderate weather as it is right now. It can be nice and balmy. So what we eat then keeps changing, and the way we cook it keeps changing, the way we treat it keeps changing, and our handling of those foods as well is different, because we do believe in the taseer issues as well. Some of them are very, very true. I mean, Ayurveda tells us, you know, Chef Rajan, I speak to Chef Gilgit.
Chef Goela has been talking about Ayurveda. Chef Goela.
Yes, Gunjan was talking about that some time ago, I believe also. And I remember Chef Gil, I said, we all talk about Alsi, you know. I mean, we all say flaxseed is the wonder little shiny piece that you should be eating. But everybody just thinks about putting flaxseed on top of maybe a loaf of bread when they bake it, and then it's sold commercially as multi-seed, multi-grain bread because it's got flax seeds in it. Or they may just say, okay, we're going to put some flax seeds into a salad or something. I mean, somebody may say, okay, we'll use it like a jeera and make a paratha and add some flaxseed into it. Little does one know that actually flaxseed is not going to get digested unless you're really chewing like a cow over 32 bites and chews to actually have it get powdered. Because when you're using flaxseed, the common housewife doesn't realize this, that it is going to just go down through the gut and be wasted completely. The benefits from flaxseed you're not even acquiring or using or absorbing into your body system unless it were powdered. And there again, I don't mean by powder that you make a big martaban and just take it in your kitchen. It will turn rancid, become absolutely useless. You have to powder small amounts
small
of
portion,
it
yeah.
in your coffee grinder or nut grinder and keep it ready to use. And I think it's such a lovely flavor if you just pick up a spoonful and pop it into your mouth. It's very close to eating a walnut really. But there again, commercially, because it has no eye appeal, flax seeds are only getting used on cookies, on lavash, and on breads on top. And they're just so useless. They're just totally wasted and nobody seems to realize it. Here again, I think educating the audience or educating the housewife or whoever's in the kitchen is all important for them to know how to be using foods. Like for example, even in a salad, people will say, gajar kaat ke dal diya humne tomato dal diya, pyaz dal diya, spring onion dal diya. Now a carrot by its own nature is when it's eaten just as raw, is not half as good as if it were blanched slightly in water or steamed gently, even in a microwave for that matter. Because when it is semi-cooked, I don't mean cooked mushy, as I said, not cooked to death of course, but if it's slightly cooked, it absorbs better. The beta carotene nutrients can be absorbed into your bloodstream much more efficiently than if it were just a raw piece of carrot. Honestly, this is very very comfortable, I think, because how much of raw carrot can you actually eat? Unless you're that Pankaj Kapoor wala Karam Chand, you can't keep eating carrots all the time. So if it has to be eaten in a larger quantity, in a copious amount, then I would say you should be mildly steaming it. A lot of foods go down much better that way. And the vitamin A is absorbed better, and so is the beta carotene, but people don't know about it. So here's two things I did think of bringing up, the flaxseed and the carrots, and of course there are several others. Chef Pankaj, I can ask you or Rajan to take on
about
other things
you
think people need to be taught about.
I agree with what you say, that we really need to understand what food to be consumed when. In early times, you know, we had particular foods for particular seasons, and that too for particular parts of the day. So this was to be eaten in the morning, this was to be eaten in the afternoon. You couldn't eat this for dinner. Things were very, very clearly specified and marked out. And I remember how...
When you talk about genetic disorders, we're talking about food which is, you see, available in the mandis, in the open markets. These hotels and restaurants are buying directly from the farms, which are organic.
No, that's not the point you're trying to make. Unfortunately, we haven't got it.
Seeds have been
genetically... You're talking about the seeds?
Modified product which is coming...
Okay, the seeds. Let's talk about seeds. Yeah, let's talk about the seeds.
This is a villain the world over, I think. The genetically modified is a scary proposition. It's happening everywhere. It is taking over in a very large fashion. And with the corruption in our country, I know my husband and I have this constant argument about organic dals and organic sugars. And I say, in India, with the amount of corruption there and how the rupee works, I'm not too sure it is even organic. We pay, you know, paying three times the money for it. So what do you know about it actually, unless you go there and pop in every now and then, like some inspector, and check out and see how the product is being treated before it comes onto the mandi in a bundle of, say, spinach or in a, you know, bunch of, say, guavas. We don't know.
Well, a lot of the five-star properties have their own pluck-to-plate farms now. They are growing their own produce. Not from where they're buying the seeds from, I would not be able to shed light on that. But yes, they are.
They all genetically.
The damage has already been done.
The basmati, yeah.
You talk about, have you heard about Bora? Have you heard of Joha? Yeah? Excellent. So one of the good rices, rice that you can eat is Bora rice, Joha rice, which are not they're untouched, I would say, genetically. Today, you can have them, and it's available all over. You can order on Amazon also.
Chef Rajan, I have something to ask you here, talking about rice. You know, brown rice took over in a very big way, and all the people who were mining their food habits as well as their diets, as well as their weights, were all talking about brown rice. I think the myth kind of got bust. I'm not too sure which side I'm on, in fact, even now, when Richita Divekar said, well, if the pressure cooker has so much trouble cooking brown rice, think of all the trouble your poor stomach chamber and muscles have to digest it. Tell me about this brown rice. I've always had this dilemma, and it's good I'm asking you today.
Research says the best type of rice to eat is the parboiled rice, because somehow it has managed to retain all the nutrients in the rice itself.
No, my question
and,
was, what about
and I'm coming
brown
to
rice?
That. Yeah, I'm coming to the brown rice as well. It's managed to retain all the good qualities while it has lost a lot of starch, which is the real culprit. So that is the best rice to eat. Coming down to brown rice, once again, yes, it says that a lot of nutrients are held back because it is not polished and the brown cover does not take away the B complexes. But yet, all the other, I would say, culprits are still there and there. The only culprit I feel is, of course, the starch in there or the carb. But yes, as far as brown rice is concerned, it does have, and the research has proved that, that it is more difficult to digest. Therefore, not suitable for all age groups. The young can definitely try their hand, and if they like it, enjoy it. But definitely not advised for babies, kids, and older generations. Right.
So thank you so much. Any more questions? This last question, please, if you would like.
Hi, ma'am. Good afternoon. I'm your great fan. So I just wish to ask that, are there any tips for newcomer who wishes to start cooking, from journey from newcomer to master chef?
There's just one tip: enjoy what you do. The moment you start enjoying cooking, it ceases to be a task or a chore. It becomes a part of what you would really love to do. But that's only one tip. There's only one tip. I started cooking at the age of 10, believe me. And I was cooking mutton by the age of 12. I remember this very distinctly because I was 13 when I lost my father. And before that, I had already been cooking muttons and parathas and everything. Right? So it was because I was interested, because I loved what I was doing. And that is the only way I know.
And if you talk about TV shows and cooking, trust me, it's not the same thing at all. When you're cooking in your own house, if something is getting burnt, you'll throw it away and start afresh. If something's got less salt, you'll taste it and put some more salt in as well. But I know, and Chef Pankaj will second this wholeheartedly, I'm sure, when you're cooking in a show and the cameras are on, the lights are on, and you've got somebody, you know, you've got Chef Kunal breathing down your back about ye kya bana rahi hai aap, and you've got Chef Ajay Chopra in the front jumping down your throat ki ye kya dal diya aapne, and then you have the superhero Akshay Kumar standing out there and gnashing his teeth and bashing his knuckles ki will this dish please me, ye mujhe khush karne layak hai.
That was because it was a challenge.
You can't cook because you just don't have your passion anymore in it, because all of frenzy, your nerves are feeling like barbed wire. And you're, you know, looking at the watch and wondering what you're going to make of it because you're running behind schedule. So cooking in your own kitchen, trust me, is a delight. After coming back from MasterChef, I realized it, you know.
No, but believe me, Kalaji, beg to differ a little bit. I've done 10 cookery shows by now. Whatever I cook on the set is real cooking, mind you. I do not allow the back end to prepare anything in advance for me. I cook on the show, I cook everything right from scratch, and believe me, by the end of it, once we have finished with the product shot, sab kha jate hain, hum log masti karte hain.
Chef Pankaj, you're talking about cooking shows and how you cook.
Yes.
I'm talking about when you're competing and
that's
you're
a different game altogether.
And they put that huge hype of fright into you, and you're trying to cook and not have them browbeat you and make you nervous about ye ab kya bana rahi hain, you know. I'm talking about that aspect of nervousness which comes when you're on the sets and you have people who are either pulling you down or making you doubt what you're doing. Ye sahi banega ki aapko lag raha hai theek lagega. I'm talking about that aspect, you know. You're, when you're cooking in a show, it's not a competition, Pankaj. That's a different story altogether.
Yeah. Thank you so much, Chef Kandla. Thank you so much, Chef Bhaduria. Thank you so much for being here and sharing your knowledge. Any more questions after we are wrapping up the session now, and any more questions you can do one-to-one with the chefs here, and I would say a big round of applause for the two women here, to women power
and to food, glorious food.
Yes, God bless all. Thanks so much for being here. Thank you.